Hey there, my name's Charles, and in this series, we're going to go through the deploying a zero trust network for web applications using an Azure reference architecture, kind of stepping through the walkthrough, the tutorial, setting up the network, an application gateway, a firewall, making all those pieces work together for an end-to-end certificate-based, TLS-based secure solution for putting a web app in Azure. So we're going to follow one of the published reference architectures. This is actually an architecture that I wrote based on using an app service as the backend for the web app, and then implementing an Azure App Gateway for the OWASP web firewall, web app firewall, and the Azure Firewall Layer 7 Packet Inspection Firewall. So we'll kind of walk through the end-to-end solution for this series of videos. Remember to subscribe to the channel, like the videos if you learn something new. Let's jump right in. So this is the Deploy a Zero Trust Network for Web Apps tutorial article that is in the Microsoft Documentation Center. On another tab here, I have kind of the outline of the different components that make up this reference architecture, kind of what we're trying to do. The idea is that we have some type of web app, web solution running. The PaaS service in Azure to do that is called an app service. It's just a simple web app service. If you think of IIS or Apache on a Windows or a Linux server, you know, just something that's going to run a web website, you can put that in an app service in Azure, and it can do the same thing. Now, an app service doesn't have any security features built in other than just offering HTTPS or TLS connections. It doesn't do web app firewall rules or filtering there. It doesn't do packet inspection like a firewall would. And so if we think of a zero trust network and having an end-to-end TLS through those different components, the reference architecture is to put an application gateway and an Azure firewall in front of that app service. That way, as the packets communicate and you try to access the website, that communication transverses both of these devices, both of these services, to make sure that the connection is both secure and kind of from a trusted or non-malicious actor. So this is the reference architecture that we'll be putting in place through these series of videos. And we'll get started just by kind of looking at the documentation, the tutorial. And the first things that we're going to do is go and deploy kind of some prerequisites, things that we need to stand this up. We'll first do a resource group. Just for the purpose of the demo, we're going to put all of our resources in one resource group that may not follow your governance strategy or best practices for your subscription, but it'll work for a demo. We are going to make this like an actual live website, so we do, to complete this demo, need a custom domain name, as well as a certificate, an actual trusted certificate for the public endpoint of the website. Both of these have already been like purchased and acquired, but if you wanted to follow this kind of end-to-end on your own, you would need those two things in advance of doing this. So we're going to jump right in. The first thing that we do is deploy some of the base resources. This will be our resource group and our virtual network to get started. Then we'll deploy the app service, then an application gateway, the firewall, then make the DNS and routing changes that we need to do to make it work. So the first steps here are to deploy the resource group. This one resource group is where everything's going to live. We have just a simple name called My Resource Group that we're going to name it. And then again, for the purpose of the demo, we're going to use the East US Azure region. Just put everything in one region. Obviously, select the region that is either closest to your users or makes sense for your governance, data sovereignty, privacy laws, all the things like that. So pretty simple to create a resource group. That'll be the first thing that we do. Pop over to the Azure portal. I'm already on the resource groups page here. We'll select create. Gonna just paste in that my resource group name. Portal's already selected East US for us. We'll review and create and then create. So pretty simple there. Got our resource group created. So this is what we'll use to put all of our Azure objects in to get this done. The next thing that we need is an Azure Key Vault. So this is what's going to store our certificate, our TLS certificate. This is what's going to be used on all three of our services. It's going to be used on the App Gateway. This is what will be presented to the end user, the client, as they connect to the website. We'll also have to put this on the Azure firewall so that it can decrypt and then re-encrypt the data as it traverses the firewall to then get to the app service. So these are the steps to deploy a Key Vault. One thing to note about Key Vault is that soft delete is enabled by default. So as you're doing this in a demo, we're gonna set the soft delete time to 7 days. That way we can delete the resource group at the end of the demo pretty easily. The default value is much higher than this, and it kind of prevents accidental deletion, kind of if you think of it like a recycle bin for your Key Vault. But we're gonna change this as we deploy it just so we can delete it a little easier later. But something to think about as you're deploying Key Vault on your own. As we deploy Key Vault, there are two pricing tiers to select. There's either standard or a premium that supports hardware security modules, HSM modules, that you could store the certificates and keys in. For this demo, we only need standard. That'll still be encrypted behind the scenes. If you need physical encryption using an HSM, then you would have to go with premium. But so we'll go back over to the Azure portal, create a Key Vault, and this is where our certificate will be uploaded. So back over to the portal here, just gonna search for Key Vaults. Gonna create a new Key Vault. We'll put it in that My Resource group that we just created. For the purpose of the demo, we're just gonna call this My Key Vault 1 now. You'll see that I've already done this demo a couple times, so that same named Key Vault already exists and is still behind the scenes because it's been soft deleted. So I'm just going to add a 1 here. East US region, same region, standard pricing tier. And then again, you'll see here that the default retention period is 3 months or 90 days. So for this, we're just going to change it to 7 so I can delete it next week. And then we'll review and create our Key Vault and create. So the Key Vault, again, is used to store certificates. It can also be used to create and store keys. If you need to bring your own key or use your own key for disk encryption, storage account encryption, database encryption, you want your own RSA key defined, you can define and store that key in a Key Vault, as well as secrets. So just kind of string-based, whether it be passwords, connection strings, you know, if it's alphanumeric characters, you can put that in as a secret, and then it would be encrypted, and you could retrieve that with an identity. So our Key Vault is created here. We're going to go to the resource, go back to our instructions. Next thing we're going to do is upload our certificate to that Key Vault. Now, there are some rules around uploading certificates. If it's a .pim file format, then it would need to have, you know, one or more of your X509 certificates. What we're going to be using is a .pfx file format. So this is where it's got the full certificate chain, the leaf certificate, as well as the intermediate and the root all in one. We're going to upload this to our Key Vault. In our case, it is a wildcard certificate, so we only have to do it once. You know, depending on your security policy, you may have specific domains or server names, common names on your certificate, and you may have to do this more than one time. But so we're on our Key Vault resource. We'll go to certificates. We'll import our certificate. Select import. We're going to name it just wildcard cert, or my trusted wildcard cert. That's the name from the docs. And I have the certificate here on the desktop. Make sure I remember the password. And we'll create and import that. So there we go. We've got our certificate imported to our Key Vault. Now we'll be able to use the certificate on our application gateway and our firewall when we get to that point. The next thing that we need to do is create a managed identity. So managed identities are kind of like service principles. They're, from an Azure perspective, they're both an Azure object, meaning an object that we'll create and deploy in our subscription, as well as an Azure Active Directory object, so an identity object in the authentication system. And so what this managed identity is going to do is that to be able to access this certificate that's in the key vault, we need an account that has permission to be able to grab or retrieve that certificate. And so the component, the other object that is going to be retrieving the certificate is the app gateway and the Azure firewall. And so we need an identity to be able to assign to both of those resources to then be able to retrieve the certificate from the secure repository, the key vault. So we're going to create this identity, which is really just kind of a service principle behind the scenes in Azure Active Directory. And then we'll assign access to this identity so that when the app gateway or when the firewall goes to retrieve it, it's going to use this identity and have the permission to do so. So we'll go back over to the portal. We'll go to managed identities. We'll create an identity here. Same resource group. You'll notice the portal does this sometimes. It defaulted the region now to North Central, so we'll change that to East US. And we'll name the identity the same from the docs. So we'll create this identity. And then as this gets created, we'll go and take a look at it real quick, just so you can kind of see as we go to the resource that it is created both an Azure object, right? Now we have this managed identity that exists in our subscription, but it's also created a service principal ID in Azure Active Directory. And so now with the service principal, we can assign permissions to this identity, associate the identity with, say, our application gateway, our firewall, and then that's how kind of the permission cycle would work. So now that we've created the identity, the next thing we'll do is create an access policy in Key Vault to allow this identity to be able to retrieve the certificate. Now there's an interesting thing about Key Vault in that even though we're only using certificates, in order to retrieve the certificate, we have to grant this identity the GET permission, so the ability to retrieve for both secret and certificates. So you would think that, well, we're only using certificates, we only have to give it certificate permission. We actually have to give it both. So we'll give it both secret and certificate, and we'll go from there. So back over to the Azure portal, we'll go back to our Key Vault, into the Zero Trust Key Vault. We're going to go to Access Policies. We're going to create a new access policy. Then on the permissions, so again, we're going to select GET for both secret and certificate. We'll go to next. And then we'll search for the name of the managed identity. What did we call that? My Managed Identity App Gateway. And so now this is that same service principal ID that it created in Azure Active Directory. So we'll select this identity, hit next, next again, and then create. And so now this identity as a service principal, as an application, has the permission to retrieve or get both secrets and certificates from the Key Vault. And then the last thing we'll do for kind of this first video for today is deploy the virtual networks. So going back over to our diagram to look at the two virtual networks that we need, using kind of this reference architecture, it's kind of a hub and spoke type model in that the firewall is going to sit in our hub virtual network. That way, if we had more websites, you know, say this was just the first web app we were deploying, and we were going to deploy a second web app or a third web app, you know, we've got other services that we need to run. Firewalls are kind of expensive. And in most scenarios, in a hub and spoke scenario, we only need one firewall, even if we've got, you know, two, three, four web apps running. And we'll just reuse that same firewall. So from an architecture perspective, we want two virtual networks in this scenario. The firewall is going to sit in our hub. and our application specific things are going to sit in a spoke, and then each additional application would just be another spoke off of that hub. So those will be the two networks that we create. The first network will be our hub network, and we're going to use a 192.168.0.0/16 address. And we're calling it hub-vnet. So we'll go back over to the portal, go to virtual networks, create our first virtual network. We'll put it in that same resource group. Virtual network name will be hub vnet. We'll go to the IP addresses tab to change the address space. So we're gonna delete this existing one, add a new address space. Starting address will be 192.168, and we'll select /16. So this will be our address space on the hub virtual network. And then we'll add a subnet based on our documentation. This needs to be a firewall subnet, so the name of the subnet has to be Azure Firewall Subnet. And then the starting address here, we'll do 192.168.0.0, and this will be a /26. /26, that'll be fine. We'll add that there, and then review and create. Now this might look a little bit different. I'm in the preview portal. As you go through this in the public portal, that interface might be a slightly different, and you would be able to use the /24. Go back over. So we've created our hub virtual network. Now we'll do the same thing for our spoke virtual network. And in this case, we're going to have two different subnets, one for the application gateway and then one for the web app. And if we go back over to the diagram, that's where in our spoke virtual network, the application gateway will be on its own subnet and the app service, the app one subnet, will be its own subnet. And in this case, we're going to use 172.16.0.0 for our spoke virtual network, just so we can kind of mentally keep them as separate things. And go back to our virtual networks, create another virtual network, select that My Resource Group, and we'll name this Spoke VNet. On the IP addresses, we'll delete this existing address space and then add in our new one. So 172.16.0.0/16. So that's our address space. And then we'll add in the two subnets that we need. So first we'll create an app gateway subnet. That'll be the first available network, 172.16.0.0 with a /24. 172.16.0.0. Change this to a 24. Hit add. And then we'll add one more subnet for app one. And that'll be 172.16.1.0. Also with a /24. So we've added our two subnets, one for our app gateway, one for our app service. We'll create that. All right. And so now our networks are created. So that's kind of it for the first part of this demo. We've created the Key Vault. We've created a managed identity to be able to retrieve things from the Key Vault. And we've created our two virtual networks. That's kind of the base foundation of what we need for the Zero Trust diagram. We've got our core networking components in place. And the next video, we'll start with deploying our app service and getting the web app up and running.